Well, welcome. Our pastor Jason just said, you know what, let's just get this thing started. It's just like a big youth gathering today. And it's loud and the music's cranking. And I think one of the things that knowing Ken for 23 years and working side by side Ken as one of the youth pastors, having him be here as a staff person, he was our facilities coordinator for many, many years. He was one of my closest friends, and I know that Ken would want us to grieve, but he would more than that want us to celebrate today. And so that's our desire, and that's why we've called this a celebration service, a celebration life service, because we want to celebrate. And as I've walked around, I know I wasn't even able to get halfway back to see the many people that, as we look at, you know, if you're, in fact, let's just start by doing this. This is kind of things that Ken would do. So if you're a Facebook friend of Ken, raise your hand. He had over 3,000 Facebook friends. If you've been given a hug, raise your hand. Okay, we'll go a little bit harder here. If you've ever been pushed down or hit by Ken Duffy, raise your hand. Okay, wow. Now, I've been thinking about the things that Steve Schmidt, there's no replacing Ken. There is no replacing Ken. But all of us are asking this question, what do we need to do differently? And so, I mean, there's questions like, do I do the wet willy? How many of you, I'm not. How many of you have been given a wet willy by Ken Duffy? Wow, that's like 300 people. How many of you know you've been prayed for by Ken Duffy? Wow. The day that Ken passed away, he was doing what he did so well on Saturdays, is that he visited people. He loved us. And I know that that's why we're here in this room. If you've been visited by Ken, raise your hand. Wow, that's a legacy. For us on the platform today, I know Pastor Phil and Pastor Jason and myself, he impacted our lives in incredible ways, and we're here because we love him. One of the things that Ken liked about me sometimes is there would be those times as a pastor where I would prepare something a lot, and I would have, you know, I'd practice, and it wasn't those times that Ken came up and gave me the big bear hug and said, like, right on the money, you know. It was when I just got up like I've done just now and just started talking. Because Ken saw the heart, and we had that like heart with each other. And so I know that on behalf of Pastor Phil and Pastor Jason and I, all three of us are walking into this very much that way today. Pastor doesn't have notes. I don't have notes. But I know Ken would just be like, right on, because it's from the heart. And you guys know that's what he loved. That was his legacy that he brought, was that his heart was the heart of Christ that loved others. And I know that as you've looked at Facebook, and if you've, you know, not everybody's been able to do that, we're working on some different things that are compiling those things. But I know just as of Monday, there was over 30 typewritten pages, because we're compiling this for a book for the family. That was just on Monday. I don't even know what it is now. I know Ellie's been typing and cutting and pasting all week. And she loved Ken too, and we wouldn't think of anything different. So, hurrah, we love Ken. I know that he would want us to worship today. That he would want us to worship a Savior, that he would want us at times to cry, at times to get on our knees, at times to raise our hands, because that's who he was. He never held back his emotions. He never held back his feelings. He let it all out. It was all on the line for Jesus Christ. Whether it was riding his bike, whether it was jumping off of a belly flop, if you've seen him with kids, you know that he loved students and he loved his granddaughters. He loved his wife. And so celebrate, laugh, cry, engage, be present today. Stephanie's coming on up. and she's going to share.
The good news is there's bright light shining in my face, so I can barely see. Unlike the pastors, I have notes because I have to get through all the boring stuff like the eulogy and facts of his life before I get to speak about what an amazing man my father was. But I'd like to start off on behalf of my mother, myself, my uncles, and the rest of my family to thank you all for coming today to celebrate my dad's life. It's so nice to see everyone here from all the different eras of my life and my dad's life. And I hope that you all get to see a little bit of how you played a part in his journey here on earth. You'll see two common themes throughout my dad's life today, that of God, family, and country, his priorities, and his desire to love God and love his people. My dad was born on May 15, 1949, to Stephen and Pauline Duffy. They lost a daughter before him and didn't believe they could have children. After adopting my dad, they went on to have three sons, my amazing, fun, supportive uncles, Uncle Martin, Uncle Steve, and Uncle Dave. My dad joined the military. He spent two tours proudly in Vietnam. Somehow in between his time in Vietnam, he convinced my mom to marry him. They happily welcomed my brother Kevin into this world, only to lose him 11 days later. As you can imagine, the reunion him and my daddy are having up there. My parents were told to wait a couple years before trying to have children again, so you can imagine the doctor's surprise when I was born on September 18, 1972. We were living at Fort Campbell, Kentucky at the time. As with the military, we didn't stay anywhere very long. We were in Fort Campbell, and then we ended up heading to Mannheim, Germany, where my dad and I, well, maybe not that tour in Germany, but one of our tours, we learned to love schnitzel. Our first tour in Germany, though, is where I caught my first fish. I was 2 1/2, and many of you may argue that a girl couldn't catch a fish at 2 1/2, but if their dad was Ken Duffy, they sure could. I kissed that fish and put it back because my daddy made me. It wasn't big enough to keep. After Germany, we were sent to Fort Polk, Louisiana. We call it the armpit, sorry if you're from there. Where as a 5 or 6 year old, I spent a lot of time out with my dad climbing trees, not tree houses, we don't have time for that, but climbing trees and hunting snakes. Now I'm not sure there were actually any snakes to hunt, but we sure hunted them. I don't know what I would have done if we had caught one. One time in Louisiana, we were fishing, and I threw out my line, and the time where you like bottom fish a little bit, you know? And so I cast, and I'm reeling in, and I feel it gets snagged on something. I keep reeling, and this thing's fighting me. Well, it gets ashore, it's an alligator. My dad's fearless. Many of you, well, all of you should know that. And so I'm standing beside him. I'm like, Daddy, Daddy, that's an alligator. And he's like, yup. I'm like, what are we going to do? He's like, let's see what it does. It ate my lunch. After our time in Louisiana, we headed back to Germany, this time to Augsburg. And my dad belonged to a great bass club out there. I grew up on the lakes. It was an awesome time. I used to tell my parents that someday I'd marry a military guy and move back to Germany. That didn't quite happen, and I'm really glad for that because I can't imagine not having been as close to my dad as I am now and ever having lived overseas away from him. We ultimately were sent back to Fort Campbell, Kentucky. At the time, though, we lived in Clarksville, Tennessee. We were told that that's where we were retired, and we were really excited about it. Felt like we could finally put down roots for once, and it was within driving distance, albeit not really close, but within driving distance to all our family in Southern Illinois, which was great. I'll never forget the day my dad came home and told me we were moving. I was sure we were moving around the corner, you know, to be closer to my friends, because I'm an only child, so it's really about me. Or that we were going to move, you know, maybe across the state line, but turns out we moved here to California, which was a real transplant for us country folk, but somehow we managed. So we moved out here in December of 84. I first came to First Baptist in 1986. My best friend, I know I saw her somewhere, the Rose, Renee Slimp, invited me to church, and that's how I got here. And Renee and I prayed one night, and I accepted Christ and became on fire for God, like ridiculous. And I would beg my parents to come to church. My mom, of course, came with me. But my dad would always have some excuse or some reason why he couldn't come, usually centered around fishing, some kind of tournament. He also liked to fish on my birthday. It's a good fishing time of year, apparently. But one day I finally just asked him, "Dad, will you come to church with me?" Well, I didn't call him Dad. I never called him Dad. "Poppy, will you come to church with me?" And he said yes, and I'd say the rest is history, but you know that's not true. He started working in the youth. One sec. He started working with the youth in about 1987 or 1988. I was glad because he started with junior high and I was in high school. So I didn't have to have him too much in my space. I know that the rest of those memories, those youth memories, a lot of you have. I've seen the stories. I've seen the posts. I welcome them. Maybe not today, but I do want to hear those stories. And more importantly, I want you to carry them. I want you to keep them. I want you to write them down. The stories you have about my father, pass them on. Tell them to your friends. Share them, because that's how we all remember him and we'll carry him with us. Don't try to forget because it hurts too bad. Carry it with you. Tell his stories to the younger generations. I'm looking at you high school kids, and they don't know. Those sixth graders, fifth graders, fourth graders, they have no idea that they're missing out on the world's best belly flop. You got to tell them, you know? And let's raise them up like my dad would, right? Just because he's gone doesn't mean we can't all carry that same passion for God that my father had. We need to spur it in the younger generation like my father would want. I've always joked that I was going to write a book, Growing Up Duffy. I'm sure it would be a bestseller. Bridget Jones and her diary got nothing on me. But here's one thing I can tell you about growing up as Duffy's daughter. One thing that as parents and children and those who will eventually become parents, one thing you need to hold on to. As Duffy's daughter, I always felt loved. Always. I was always supported. Always. I was always accepted, even when I did things that were unacceptable. And I might have done a few. My dad loved me and supported me through everything. And I may have disappointed him at times, but it didn't change the fact that he loved me, and I knew it. And if there's anything you can do for your children, that's what you need to instill in them. To know a father's love and to know that your father loves you and accepts you for who you are and is there for you and will fight for you. There's no other feeling. I have no regrets with my dad. I miss him more than words can say. It's nothing I'll ever be able to even come close to replacing or getting over. But I know that my father loved me, and I know that he knew I loved him. I know some of you know me. You see me around, and you're like, "That's Duffy's daughter. She's not as outgoing as Duffy." But I'm going to be real honest with you. I started out telling you I'm an only child, and I am. So I was always just a little bit jealous of you guys. Sharing doesn't come easy as an only child. And I grew up with the pre-Christ Duffy, who was loving and supportive, but not always as fun. And sometimes might have been crazy in a different way. So when he first started working with youth, I was a little jealous, because everybody would come up to me and tell me, "Oh, you're so lucky to be Duffy's daughter." And I'd remember back to that spanking or that. Might have deserved it, but you know. And even as an adult, when I first started coming back here to First Baptist, I don't know, about 4 years ago, 3 years ago, I didn't realize the impact my father made. I thought he was just like the old guy you all tolerated. I really did. I thought he was like pretty helpful and he did belly flops, and I never understood his impact until I started coming back here and seeing these youth and seeing my granddaughters and really having adult conversations with them. And now, of course, in his death, it's hit me in ways that I never wanted to understand it. My dad left this world way too soon and way too suddenly for any of us. But even with this sudden departure, I had no regrets, as I said earlier. And at this point, I think it's only fair that my brother Kevin get some time with my dad. I mean, I did hog him for 40 years, so at least I know I've got two guardian angels now. I would ask you, though, my closing remarks is just that you check your hearts. And you ask yourself if your loved ones know that you love them. Let nothing be left unsaid. My dad left nothing unsaid. If he saw you and he left you, he said bye and he loved you. There was not a doubt. Our favorite saying growing up was "bye, love you, see ya." We said it on the phone. I had to stop myself. Sometimes I'd be at work and hanging up with somebody and say "bye, love," or you know, dating someone. And, "Oh, no, not, don't love you." sorry, voice. But that was our saying. I mean, those are the things. Don't have any regrets, folks. Let people know that you love them. That's the legacy my dad left, a legacy of love. You'll hear of other legacies, but for me, as his daughter, that was it. And don't waste the opportunity to support your children. We're all busy. Everyone gets busy. Your kids need you there. There was not an event, not a thing I went to that my dad wasn't right there. My grandchildren, I'll tell you the same thing. My grandchildren, whoa. My children, woo. My children will tell you the same thing. There's not an event that their grandparents weren't at, because he loved them and he knew it meant so much to them. And just watch your words. You never know what your last words may be to someone. Lastly, please always keep in mind my father's priorities. I think they're pretty good ones. God, family, country, and last of all, love God and love his people. Now my amazing daughter, and cancer survivor. She hates it when I say that. Like me.
I knew there was two things that were missing. One, needed to pray for this morning and get us started. Two, adjust that microphone. Lord God, thank you for already what we've heard, and we just pray that you would continue to guide and direct and to work in our hearts and our minds, Lord. Father, we know that Ken loved God with all his heart, mind, soul, and strength. And so stir in us, Lord, that kind of passion and love for you and for others that he had. And even right now, as Sydney shares, Lord, just continue guide her heart and her mind as she processes her deep love for her grandpa. Thank you so much that we can be here today. In Jesus' name, amen.
little intimidated. Well, if you don't know, I'm the oldest of the granddaughters, and then there's Justin above me, but I'm one of the lucky five who got to say that he was my grandpa. And before this week, I never really knew that I would always say when I was younger that I wanted to be like my grandpa when I grew up, because, I mean, everybody would always be like, oh my God, that's your grandpa. And I kind of was like, I want to be like that. But after this week and seeing all the people he's impacted and just realizing how many people he's saved and the impact he's made, I can gladly tell you why I want to be like my grandfather. But I also know that after this week, he would not want us to be sad, but just continue doing what he was doing. And my life will be forever impacted and changed because of the life my grandpa led. And I'm grateful for the time and memories I do have of him, because I know not a lot of people have such a great relationship with their grandfathers like I did. And the last time I saw my grandpa teach, because I did not get to see him teach a lot, was at winter camp over New Year's Eve, and he taught on Ephesians 6:10-18, which was one of his favorite verses, so I thought I'd share it with you. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggles is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand on your ground, and after you've done everything to stand, stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in the place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the spirit on all occasions, which with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. This verse was the last seminar I ever heard him teach on. And my grandpa was really, he had a coin in his wallet that he always carried around with the different parts of the armor of God. And he was pretty in our family for known for just whipping that out and teaching you on it at random times. And on a closing note, not many people can be like my grandpa, but I hope to be able to be half the person he was one day. I will miss many little things about my grandpa, like him teaching me how to fish and saying I was his hero, even though he is mine. Also, I will miss our talks, but I can just see him up there happier, and he's looking down on us smiling. So we must not be sad, but do as my grandpa would say and love God and love his people.
Well, I love her, but I love to fish. I spend all day out on this lake, and hell is all I catch. But today she met me at the door, said I would have to choose. If I hit that fishing hole today, she'd be packing all her things and she'd be gone by noon. Sometimes I think, what will people say of me when I'm only just a memory? When I'm home where my soul belongs, was I love when no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of us? Was my worship more than just a song?
One by one they came, far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices made, unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaimed. I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. For I am a life that was changed.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave.
Can you hear me, Mike? Good. My name is Martin Duffy, and what Stephanie said. Thank you. Wow. Can't follow you, Steph. Like I said, my name's Martin, and I'm the third of us four brothers, the four Duffy boys. And I have notes, not because I don't know what I'm going to say, but because if I didn't have notes that I followed, we'd be here till dark. And I promise to keep this brief. And I can't remember everything about Kenny Duffy, but I can remember everything that happened while he was in New Haven. As Stephanie said, our parents, Steve and Paulina Duffy, adopted Kenny in 1951, when he was 2 1/2. And then my brother Stevie came in 53, and I was born in 1954, and our youngest brother, David, was born in 1957. Unfortunately, he's working for the federal government today, and they wouldn't let him off to be here with us. You'll probably hear the rest of that story later. We were a rowdy bunch of boys, I'm telling you. When David Duffy was born, our youngest brother, my dad liked 2 days being 51 years old. And it's no wonder we were treated more like grandkids than his kids. And we were then, are today, the four luckiest boys in the world. I'm just going to tell you a couple stories today about Kenny, because if he was here, I couldn't tell these stories. He made me promise to never tell these stories out loud. And these are just going to be two or three of 2,000 or 3,000 I could tell. And I was just wondering, this is not my notes, but do any of you ever remember seeing him raise that right eyebrow? He had your attention then. Kenny had fun growing up. We all had fun growing up. We had ponies when we were little. Kenny rode Patsy and I rode Major. Hope I don't need those. But a friend of ours just reminded us before we came out, our neighbor lived in a big two-story home with a big front porch on it. And one day we were riding and Kenny was on Patsy and he decided to visit Dorsey, believe it or not. He wanted to visit. And Dorsey was sitting on his front porch, so Kenny and Patsy just went up the stairs to the front porch. And it scared poor old Dorsey Medlin to death. It really did. But after it, he laughed, and thankfully nobody, including the porch, got hurt that day. But Kenny was riding Patsy one day, and she took a bad step and slipped and fell, and it broke his leg. So he had a cast from his ankle to his hip. And so that was in the summertime. About 2 weeks later, 3-4 weeks later probably, he got to take his cast on vacation with us to Hot Springs, Arkansas. And so we were there and having fun, and it was pretty cool because back then the hotel we stayed at had a swimming pool, and we spent 14 days and 14 nights in a swimming pool. But Kenny, of course, with a broken leg, couldn't go swimming. So one day we were roughnecking, for the lack of a better word, and Kenny decided, our cousin Rick Lowe was, and his family were there, and Rick was standing by the pool, and Kenny decided to push Rick in the pool. So he come hobbling up to get to Rick and was going to push him in the pool, and right when Kenny got to him, Rick stepped aside. Now this is Kenny with a broken leg. He goes belly first into the deep end of the swimming pool in Hot Springs, Arkansas. And folks, I promise you, that was the best belly flop Kenny Duffy ever did in his life. but he did do a belly flop. And that was in 1965. And I don't know if all of you know this, but Kenny Duffy liked to collect knives. I was told there was actually a time at Ridgeway High School that our principal, Paul Cotton, took 6 pocket knives off of Kenny. And Kenny was the littlest of the group growing up. And when little, I'm talking he was 5'7", 5'8", weighed about 65 pounds. But the biggest guys in school were scared to death of Kenny Duffy. They were scared to death of him. But he took 6 knives, and when he got out of the principal's office, he pulled that big 6-inch blade knife out of his boot. And he told his friends, he said, "He missed this one, it's my favorite." But Kenny, he really had a true love for knives. And this story is my favorite, the one that he promised I'd never tell anybody. But when he had his broken leg, we were in the basement one day, playing, as he put it. And there were several in there. If Brent Browning and Bird Stallings and Jim Sagasser and Tony Cox were here today, they'd attest to what I'm getting ready to tell you. Stevie was with us, so he can affirm what I'm getting ready to say happened. But Kenny liked to play with his knives, and he decided that we need to line up in front of the fruit closet door. And it was a wooden door. And we had to stand there and spread our legs as wide as we could spread them and hold our arms out. This is a true story, folks. I'm not making this up. He's standing there with our arms out like this, and yes, he stuck knives in the wall, in the door, at every one of us. And we was walking through there like soldiers. He'd say, "Next." We walk off, and the next one would come up, and he had 6 or 8 pocket knives, and every one of them had a real sharp point on them, and he stuck every one of those knives in that fruit closet door. And we used to go down there later and show you the knife sticks in the wall to tell people that story, and my mother went to her grave thinking that that didn't happen. She really did not believe that he did that. But he didn't hit any of us. I said that knife story is my favorite. It wasn't. I lied to you. I'm getting ready to tell you my favorite. To say Kenny Duffy was a mischievous child would be like saying Moby Dick is a minnow. That's just the kindest word I could come up with to describe Kenny Duffy as a child. Now, don't get me wrong. Kenny Duffy loved everybody growing up, but he was mean. This is a true story too, and you're not going to believe this one. Him and his buddy Moose and George Littleton and Jack Stallings decided one time that they'd borrow a bridge out sign. In case you didn't hear me, it was a bridge out sign. And they... For you older folks might remember it. The kids in the room won't, but they, in road construction, they used to have these little black smudge pots with a wick, and when they had road construction, they just put kerosene in there and light those wicks at night to warn people of road construction. So Kenny and Moose and Jack and George borrowed a bridge out sign. Sorry, Jesus. They borrowed a bridge out sign and a couple of those little smudge pots, and they waited till after dark. And we live in New Haven. We live right on the Little Wabash River. And there's a Little Wabash River bridge. Most of you probably know where this is headed. They go over there that night, and they light those little smudge pots, and they set up that sign right at the base of the Little Wabash Bridge. bridge out. They crawl under the bridge, and Kenny said after about the third car that comes sliding across the bridge sideways with the headlights pointed right straight down river, they decide that probably it's time to quit this practical joke. But I've tried in my mind imagining what it would be like in those days to come up onto a bridge that says bridge out. I just can't imagine. Kenny's first big camping trip was to back home. We have a camp called Camp Ondesunk in Southern Illinois. That's where he liked to catch snakes. And he loved to catch snakes. God. He'd camp in tents and learn to wash in the lake. And Kenny caught more snakes as a child than they've got in the San Diego Zoo. He'd catch them and scare people, scare the girls. They'd just scream. And his camping all started at Camp Ondesunk. And it obviously stayed with him his whole life. I can't hardly see. Stephanie's right. The lights are bright. But I really don't know, but I think there's several here that's probably been to camp with Kenny today. Stand up. If you've been to camp with Kenny, and those of you in the front, turn around and look. Those that just stood are Kenny Duffy's heroes today, I promise you. Kenny graduated high school and joined the Army and for the lives of Stevie Duffy and David Duffy, and Martin Duffy, our home life became much less eventful. But I'm here to tell you that Kenny Duffy's soul will forever be in our little hometown. The hometown that Kenny loved. I could stand here all day and tell you stories about Kenny Duffy's childhood. But today I'm thinking about his adulthood. I'm going to say today that the life he led, in my opinion, qualifies him for sainthood. Please keep Paula, Stephanie, Anthony, Michael. And all these beautiful grandkids, and all our thoughts and prayers. Kenny Duffy, you are loved.
My name's Fred Preston, and I'm here to tell you that Kenny was my best friend. Y'all know he was a fisherman. But I was kind of that guy that he fished with a lot. Back in 86, he joined a bass club up in Marysville. He thought it was a better club and a better area than what he was offered down here. And it also offered him a national opportunity to fish big tournaments. What can you say? Everybody that has talked yesterday and today have all said the same thing, and just kind of, I don't have an awful lot to say except for what Kenny had experiences with me. We used to plan fishing trips we'd go over to Clear Lake, or we'd go over to the Delta, or we'd go here, go there. And he'd come up to the house and spend all night. My wife's from Kentucky, and he started talking about these places in Kentucky, and the next thing you know, it's like old home week. You know, they really enjoyed each other and had a lot in common. He used to come home. Paula told me yesterday that he used to come home and says, "Hey, that woman up there cooks that Kentucky food. Well, how come you don't? How about you help me out?" She says, "Buddy, you're out of luck." So there was a lot of things about Kenny, but one of the things, after he joined our club, he had this, it was a Skeeter bass boat, and it was gold metal flake. Beautiful little boat. But if you're familiar with hydroplane racing or anything like that, that's kind of how Kenny was. You know, he knows two speeds, dead stop or flat out going. And everybody that fished with him over the years, you know, they always had something to say about how quick he got from one place to another and how fast he was to jump up to run to another place. That's just the way Kenny was. He lived big, he did big, and, you know, there was no part way about anything with him. Everybody has said and talked about how he loves and how he cares for people, but, you know, I learned a long time ago that you don't want to be on his bad side. You know, and Kenny he could hold a grudge, let me tell you. There was a guy in our club one time. We were all set up. We were going to fish a little club tournament and teamed up to go up to Lake Oroville and fish. And Kenny says, "Well, I'll meet you up there at the ramp and we'll go out for the day and all that." So Kenny shows up and we're all standing around there, you know, and come launch time, we start launching. Well, there's no boater for Kenny. And he'll be here in a minute. Well, we went out and left Kenny standing on the bank, knowing, hey, your guy's going to be there in a minute. We came back in, Kenny was still standing on the bank. Let me tell you, today, Kenny still knows that man's name. I'm telling you, he's on his bad side. So, you know, that's just the way it was. Him and I were supposed to be today over at Clear Lake fishing for fish with minnows, for bass over there with minnows. Last year we had done this about this time, and we went over there fishing, and we're on this big rock pile out there, and we're catching one fish after another, and that's really not an exaggeration. We caught a lot of fish that day. And he has this big crappie comes up, chases him, his minnow to the boat, and he's all excited about that and everything. And next thing you know, he gets hooked up with a fish, doesn't know what it is, and I thought it was going to drag him in the lake, and it ended up was a 12-pound catfish. He said that's the biggest fish he'd ever caught in his life and was pretty excited about it. So, you know, experiences like that, I had many opportunities with Ken. It was something that I can never forget, that I'll always remember. And anybody that ever fished with him or was involved with what he did, those are the kind of experiences that you always went away with. In conclusion, Ken Duffy had a big love for everybody. He never knew a stranger. He loved kids, he loved adults. I think one of the pastors said yesterday that Kenny had a BS meter too. So, you know, but that's the way it was. That was Kenny. He really loved big, and he lived big. He lived for the day, the excitement. He enjoyed every moment, every second of all the times he had with everybody. He continually talked to me about his times with the children. My daughter and her girlfriend were able to go to camp when she was about 12 or 13, and they went up to winter camp up here in Tahoe, got snowed in, and from the way she relates it, it was one of the best times she ever had. Kenny Kenny was Kenny. They had snowball fights. They rolled in the snow. He had played tricks on the cabins and all of that stuff. Now, that's just the way it is. But also, Ken Duffy is going to create a huge void in our lives. You can't replace him. There's nobody out here that can come up and say, hey, I'm Ken Duffy. There's nobody that can do that. But we can remember him, hold him in our hearts, remember the things that you've done with him and the things that he has done, and continue on. God bless.
Every time I saw Ken, he would give me a really big hug and tell me how beautiful I was. Whenever I was around Ken, I felt beautiful and valued.
What Ken Duffy's done for me is he taught me that I'm never alone with God, and because I've always, for a while, I had felt so just lost and not knowing who I was and who I was going to be, and Ken just helped me realize who I was when he just taught me that God loves me and he has purposes for me.
There's less than 65 years of life. He lived a fuller life than somebody could have in 100 years. And in everything he did, he glorified God.
Ken really impacted my life seventh grade year when I was at winter camp. I told him that I didn't know if God really loved me, but he woke me up in the middle of the night and he's like, what are you doing? I was like, I'm sleeping. And he's like, hey, guess what? I was like, what? What are you doing? He's like, God loves you. I was like, Ken, go back to sleep.
Ken Duffy was my counselor. He was there when I accepted Christ. He taught me the power of prayer. He taught me to love others, and it's sad to let him go.
Ken Duffy's impacted my life ever since junior high. I have a picture here of Meadow Ranch. He was the camp counselor, and I wore his cowboy hat around the whole week. He let me have it and probably got a burnt neck out of it, but I wanted to be like Ken even then, and I still want to be like Ken.
The greatest thing that God's ever been able to do with my life to this point, to use me, is that he let me be in class with Stephanie Duffy, three classes freshman year, and we became friends, and that gave me the courage to share my faith with her, and she became a Christian and then brought her family. And Ken's been the most amazing example of a Christian I've ever known, and he's the only person who's ever come to my house and visited me regularly. Not one person from this church in all these years has done a visit like that. That was just Ken. He was so loved everybody all the time, the most loving, wonderful, encouraging man ever.
One thing that Ken really taught me is not just come to church or anything. He taught me to pray and pray wholeheartedly for God as if I'm speaking to him directly. And that's one thing I'll never forget. And it's truly because of Ken that I accepted Christ into my life. And he's a treasured man in my heart, and I know he is to many.
Ken has impacted my life so much. See? He always would come to my house and support us.
Ken Duffy has been the rock of my life. Whatever he does, he just compliments you whether you're having a bad day, and he puts a smile on your face.
Ken Duffy has impacted my life by teaching me how to be a man of God and telling me the responsibilities and duties of being a man of Christ. And he was one of the perfect examples of a man of Christ.
I've never known anybody so encouraging and loving as Ken Duffy. For the last 20 years, I've gotten to see his life lived out as an example of Christ. And that example is something now that I feel compelled to emulate. If I can just do just a portion of what Ken was able to do with his life, then I'll count it worth it.
I wasn't able to pray when I was younger, and Ken was there for me, and he was one of the... He just taught me that love and prayer are the strongest things in this world. And that man, he just did so much for all of us, and I love him so much.
Ken Duffy was a man of unlimited kindness. And I think that we really need to continue that on now that he's gone, because he wouldn't have wanted us to just stay sad. He would have wanted us to continue his legacy.
Ken, you impacted my life from the day I met you. I have always loved you, and I always will love you. You've had such an impact not only on many students' lives, but in the way that I view students' lives and the way that I know that I'm loved by God. And thank you for ministering to me for so many years.
Ken Duffy loved on my children. He taught them how to pray, and he showed them how to love God. And for that, I'll be forever grateful.
Ken Duffy taught me so much about loving kids and loving God's people. And he touched so many kids' lives because God used him, and he let himself be used by God.
He's a man you can never forget, that you should never forget. If you've been touched by him, you're blessed. He was an amazing man, and we'll all miss him.
Ken, thanks for showing that Jesus is in everything in life, whether that's motorcycle riding or hanging out with junior hires or being in the military or whatever, and giving us that example to carry Jesus into every part of our lives too.
He showed me what it means to really, really love and care for people who you think are so far gone, but really they need Jesus' love too.
Ken's impacted my life in so many ways. 23 years of knowing you and knowing that you love me and you love God, and you've impacted my life just so amazingly. Words are just, I can't explain how much a difference you've made in countless thousands of people's lives. And I consider you my best friend, my hero. I know you always called me your pastor, but in the same way, I saw you in that same way. You were always my go-to man. I love you, and I just hope that everybody will see the incredible impact that you've made. Love you.
I can't remember ever not knowing Ken. And I know that in the darkest point of my life, when Jesus was pulling me out of all the crap I've been through, Ken was right there to show me what it was like to have a hug by God. And I'm forever grateful.
Ken was a man that just had so much wisdom and so much love for everyone that he came in contact with. Ken was just the definition of a life lived for Christ. And I know that anyone who's known him is going to continue living the way he did, and his legacy will live on through everyone that he touched.
One of the ways that Ken helped me out was he made me want to come to church. Like, I was new here and I didn't really know anybody, so I didn't want to be here. But after I got to know him, we became really good friends, and he was the reason why I came to church.
Ken Duffy impacted my life in more ways than I could say. I guess if I summed it up, he was Jesus with skin on in my life.
I love you so much, and I'm so grateful for the time that I had with you. Thank you for teaching me how to be a prayer warrior.
Without him, I wouldn't be in ministry. Without him, I wouldn't know how to love people. Without him, I wouldn't have a servant's heart. He taught me how to serve. He taught me how to love. And he taught me how to give. And that legacy will forever live on in my life.
If there's one thing that Ken has taught me, it's that as Christians, we have to love God. And we have to love his people. And yesterday, on Saturday when he died, we arranged to go downtown and serve the homeless and love God and love his people. We weren't with the church. We were just a bunch of teenagers who go here and we're like, oh, we want to do what Ken wants us to do, and we want to do what God wants us to do, and we want to love God and love his people. And so the same hour that that Ken went to go be with Jesus, we handed out our first water bottle and our first granola bar and our first pair of socks, and we told people that God loves them. And it was just like, that's Ken's legacy, you know? It's time for us to step up. And Ken is, he has taught us, and now we can go forth in his place. But he will leave a legacy behind of prayer and of love and of reaching out to people. And that's just so incredible. So even though I love him and I miss him so much.
Ken has impacted my life because he's taught me to show respect to others. He's converted hundreds of people. To me, he's practically as good as John and Luke and the rest of those guys.
Now that's a statement, isn't it? I hope that, I know you were listening to that, but I hope what you heard, it pierced you to a point where as we grieve, we're asking ourselves the question, what does God want from me? I wanted to ask if you are a student at any point in the last several decades, as Ken has been a leader in this entire community, who was touched and your life was directed toward Jesus Christ in any way, if you would stand right now, please. I want you to stay standing, if you'd stay standing. Because we could have done those stories forever. And Paula and Stephanie and Anthony, I want you guys to notice the impact. And all of us, brothers and aunts, and uncles and friends who maybe are coming to a full understanding of the impact that this man has had in our lives. I just wanted you to have a chance to see it. You guys can be seated. As a pastor, and my name's Jason, by the way, and I serve as one among many amazing pastors at our church. I'm proud of them. You ask yourself, you know, we have a conviction as followers of Jesus that the moment our days on earth are done, as God would direct that, we go into the presence of the Lord in a place called heaven. And it's a wonderful place, and there'll be a great reunion one day there. In fact, Kevin and his daddy are hanging out today. But you ask yourself, and I've been asking myself this all week, what would you say? What would Ken say? I think one thing he would say is, why in the world are Pastor Steve, Pastor Phil, and Pastor Jason wearing suits? That's probably something that he wouldn't appreciate, but we felt like we should have. It just felt like we should have done that. I think the other thing he would say to you, Stephanie, is that your words were, they were amazing, profound from your heart. And he's saying, that's my girl. So well done, Stephanie. and Sydney, a huge smile on Grandpa's face at your courage to testify of what he taught you. Last time I saw Ken Duffy was at winter camp, and he was a hillbilly gangster dressed up. And it was a frightening sight, actually. While Ken called me pastor, I call him pastor. He pastored me. Ken Duffy taught my son how to fish. And he is, it's been said, and I don't need to say it again, but he's the personification of what it means to be a Christ follower, like I've never seen in my entire life. He is that golden soul that, as a pastor, I know Steve and Phil would testify to this, of the kind of friend you want to walk with you in ministry, and he's irreplaceable. And on Sunday morning, I was standing here in front of our congregation, and I looked to that spot where Ken and Paula and Mike always sit, and they weren't there, and that was hard. But I also know that there is hope that follows this grief we feel, and I want to talk about that. Stephanie's words were powerful. Stephanie, you ought to be a preacher. In fact, put a resume together. You might have a job here soon. She talked about what it means for you to be right with the people around you and let there never be any unfinished business. Ken Duffy left this world far before we would have wanted. And were we to have the choice, he'd say, God, you can't have him. We want him. He's ours. We don't get to make that choice. And so the days are precious, and so you do business, and Ken Duffy left nothing unfinished in this world. And she challenged you today. It's not just for you to be here to remember, but for you to be challenged to make sure that the people in your life know you love them and do what needs to be done. But I want to talk, just in the couple minutes I have with you, to share about what it might look like for you to get right with God. What it might look like for you to respond to God. There's no way in planet Earth we could have a memorial service for the life of Ken Duffy and not talk about Jesus and the gospel. And so we on behalf of the family, want you to know what drove this guy. He was a powerful man. He was deeply gracious and kind, a man of conviction and truth. He embodied this quality that Jesus embodied perfectly in the balance between grace and truth. You were loved, but he loved you so much, never to leave you where you are. And he got on that bike, and he got in that truck, and he drove around this city, and he told the world, he told this community, and told these students the truth. They knew they were loved, and they knew that they needed to be challenged, and they were challenged by Ken's life. Ken had two phrases that he loved, and we'll hear one of them, I'm sure, at some point. I don't know when, but it'll come up, this phrase, "I love you, God." And we'll probably hear that in decibel levels. You might not appreciate, but we'll hear that in a little bit. The other phrase that Ken Duffy loved is the phrase, "Salvation has come to the house of the Lord." And if you're not part of First Baptist Church, we have a tradition here that when someone comes to know Jesus Christ, when they give their life to him, when they surrender to his powerful, profound, outrageous love, we fill white balloons. Pastor Steve does this faithfully. And when it happens, we put those balloons right over there on that part of the platform. Ken and Paul and Mike are faithfully at the third service. They sit right over there. And Ken comes up to me before the service if I'm doing the sermon, and he says, "At what point are you going to talk about those balloons?" And there's two messages there. One is, if you forget to talk about the balloons, I will kill you, Pastor. So the message was received. And the other message was, we must celebrate salvation. And you do this Christian thing long enough, sometimes you grow a little bit numb, and he never grew numb and wouldn't allow us. So we would say, "Hey, you see the white balloons, anyone from 1 to 100. And we want to celebrate that God has changed lives and people have come to Christ." And then you'd hear the... And the next thing I knew, almost every time, Ken Duffy would stand up and he would march down this aisle right here. He would come running down the aisle, and I'm about to start the sermon, and I know that the service is over at this point. Ken's going to come because he is not satisfied with how people have responded to the truth that people have passed from death to life. And he did laps in this aisle until the crowd was raucous enough, loud enough to celebrate what this had done. And until it met his satisfaction, we couldn't do church anymore. It was over. Stop it until it's ready. And there were times, and there were visitors, and there were people that were going, "Who is this crazy guy running around the room?" And I didn't have anything to say. I would stand over there because there was no power left. I couldn't do a thing until it was ready. And I just waited for it to happen. And he conditioned us to celebrate the power of the gospel. The Bible says that Jesus gave his life that people might be forgiven, and not just forgiven of their sins, but being given an invitation to live a brand new, redeemed, transformed, gospel-driven, God-glorifying life. And no one did it better than him. And so today, as much as we've loved what's happened, this service wouldn't be complete unless you understood, maybe this morning for the first time, what Jesus did for you. Today we're mourning, and Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5 that I'll draw near to you. Another occasion in the Gospel of John when a pair of sisters were mourning the loss of a brother, much like you would understand as Ken's brother today, mourning the loss of your brother. His name was Lazarus, and he had died, and Mary and Martha, his sisters, they were all very close to Jesus, and they sent word to Jesus, "Hey, Lazarus is sick," hoping that he would come and heal him. And the Bible says in John chapter 11 that Jesus hung back for a couple extra days. Lazarus died. Mary and Martha are saying in their hearts some of the same things that we're saying today. What happened, God? Why would you do this? Why did you take our brother? There's even a scene when Jesus says to Mary and Martha, "Where's the tomb? Where have you laid my friend?" And it's his desire to travel to their deepest pain with them, to go to the place that memorializes their struggle. And the text says, Jesus wept with them. He saw the mourning and he felt this unexplainable compassion and grief for them. And so I want to say to you, Stephanie and Anthony and Paul and Mike, as you cry, and don't ever feel like you got to get over this, you never will, but we go forward and a spirit of grief, but a spirit of hope together. Jesus went with them. Jesus is going to go with you. But there's a moment before Jesus acts powerfully to raise Lazarus from the dead where he clarifies what these two sisters understand about him. They're obviously angry. Martha comes out and says, "If you had come, he wouldn't have died." And Jesus says to her, "Your brother's going to rise again." And Martha says, "Yes, I understand that there will be this resurrection, and I don't fully get all, but I understand, I've heard about that part." And then he says these words to her, which we hang on to today as a people who wonder, "God, what have you really come to offer us?" And maybe you're here today and you're just here because in some way, whether through a fishing club or a motorcycle group or some youth group that you were a part of, and maybe you've fallen away from God, and maybe you've not even understand all that we've talked about the impact that this guy made on these students' lives and all of our lives. And here's what Ken Duffy really understood. Here's what he lived his life to proclaim. He said, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Ken Duffy did not die last Saturday. He passed to a place where he belongs. That's home. And then he asks Martha in her grief, as she's wondering, why did this happen? This amazing question that I want to ask you. He says to her, "Do you believe this? Do you believe? Will you say yes to your belief that I am the resurrection and the life, that I am not just life here, I am life eternal, that I am personifying for you the power of resurrection? I don't have access to resurrection life. I don't know about it. I don't teach about it. I am it. And if you say yes to me, you're saying yes to eternity." The things you loved about Ken Duffy that we will cry and miss are the things that Jesus did in him. He was Jesus, as Phil said, with skin on, because Ken Duffy said yes to Jesus. And there may be people this morning that need to say yes to him. So I want to do something a little unconventional. Because I'm envisioning my friend running around this room, and if I don't get this right, this service can't end ever. So I want y'all to close your eyes and bow your heads with me, everybody, if you would do that now. Maybe this is the first time you've ever done this. No one's going to take anything from you. Just trust me, if you would. Bow your heads, close your eyes, because eternity right now is at stake. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world, the world of all people everywhere, that he gave his only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but would have everlasting life." And to you right now, Jesus is saying in this gathering for this purpose of remembering this man's life, he is saying to all of us, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if they die, yet will they live forever. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." And if God's Spirit is stirring within you as you hear these stories and you understand the challenge that this man's life puts before us, and you hear the God who made you, who ferociously loves you, who's not seeing your potential or what you could be, but loves you just the way you are, and offers you the power of forgiveness and restoration and eternal life, and he's saying to you right now, "Do you believe this? Do you want this? Do you want Jesus the way Ken Duffy knew him?" Then I want you right now, between me, you, and the God who made you, if you would raise your hand right now, put it up in the air. You want Jesus. You don't have every question answered. You don't know all the ins and outs. You don't know when to stand up or sit down. You don't have a Bible. You don't understand, but you just know because God's Spirit is compelling you I want this Jesus. I want to be forgiven. I want eternal life. I want my life to matter in eternity. And you're saying yes. Put your hand up right now. Do it again if you already did it. Put it up. Yeah. All over the room. Father, we're amazed at what you do. Wrestled all week. How do you summarize this man? How do you do it? And Lord, we just did. Even in his death, people have come to know your life. Thank you for what he leaves us. Not just memories, but a challenge to go forward, as Paige Middleton shared so profoundly. To be your people. To love you and your people. God, for those who've raised their hands today, I pray that you would, your spirit would prompt them to engage. I pray that they'd reach out to some church somewhere to get grounded, to become what this guy was, a soldier for the kingdom of Christ and one who brought hundreds to Jesus. Thank you, God, for doing it again this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Yeah. I was going to ask for it, but you guys just went after it. That's great. Kelsey Buford has written a poem that I got to hear this last week. Kelsey, this poem is, although she's a talented, amazing young girl, this one came straight from heaven. It's about Ken Duffy, and before we worship powerfully the name of Jesus, we've asked Kelsey to come and read that poem. Would you read that now? Would you welcome Kelsey this morning?
I honestly don't even remember writing this poem. It's not in my recollection. It was straight from God, and I just wanted to share it with you guys this morning. It's called Heaven's Warrior Angel. Today, the greatest warrior to ever walk the earth walked straight into heaven where he experienced new birth. The angels all rejoiced as he walked right on in, and God smiled with heaven's biggest grin. He looked to Ken and said, "Well done, my beloved son. You did all I asked of you, and now your work is done." And though it's hard for us to have to say goodbye, he's looking down on us just to wonder why we cry. Because he is happier than he has ever been, and he wants us all to celebrate the life that he did win. It's time to be thankful for the past instead of crying that it's through. Time to hold on to the memories, but allow God to make us new. Time to take all that he has taught us, from prayer to faith to hope, and embrace it with all we have instead of mourning just to cope. And even though we want him here, his legacy lives on, right inside each of our hearts, so he's never really gone. And although Earth lost a warrior, a grandpa, a father, a son, heaven gained the perfect angel whose life just has begun. And I can hear all the angels as they all applaud, led by Ken Duffy, yelling, "I love you, God!"
I'm Close to your side. running free. It's at the mention of your name, King of yeah.
as I was thinking about this moment, as we close and as I follow this song, thanks for that. I was thinking, how could it be that Stephanie and Paula could ask us to sing that song on a day like this? And it's only because of the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ that makes this a happy day. Amen? The greatest day in history, not today, but the day that Christ died on that cross, and a few days later when he rose from the grave to forever conquer death and sin, and some of you are experiencing that today for the first time. And I realize that this is a moment to celebrate. We miss Ken. We do. All of us are here because we deeply mourn and we hurt and we miss Ken. But we can celebrate because of the hope we have in life past this life. We know that this is not the final bell for Ken's life. This is not the end. There is life forever in Christ. I think if Ken were in this room today, he would say some familiar words to us. He'd share with us 2 Timothy chapter 4. He'd say, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And here's the good stuff. Not only to me, Paul writes, but also to all who have longed for his appearing, for Christ coming back, for the hope that they have in the Almighty God of creation that we just sang to and praised, that there is hope for all of us who embrace him. And some of us experience that today for the first time. And so I want to invite you. Go for it. That's good. And so I want you to know, if you experienced Christ for the first time today, if you raised your hand earlier and surrendered your life to him, we have some friends up here who would love to just talk with you through that and find out what's God doing in your heart and in your life and pray with you. And so I invite you to come up here as we close in a minute. But let's just celebrate that this is a happy day. Amen? Yeah. Let me pray. I'll give you a couple closing instructions and we'll head on out of here, okay? Almighty God, I thank you for the joy it is to call ourselves yours today. Thank you for the opportunity to celebrate such a life well-lived as Ken Duffy's. Thank you for the privilege that it was to know him so well and to live life alongside him, to see you honored and constantly changing this man to look a little bit more and more like you. God, today we pray for Paula, we pray for Stephanie, pray for this whole family as they deeply, deeply miss their beloved Ken. God, we pray for your peace to be on them, for your comfort. Lord, you promise in your word that your spirit is our comforter. We embrace that today. You promise that you are a prince of peace, so we embrace your peace today. God, I pray that your loving arms would enfold this family today and all of us who are hurting as we miss them. God, we pray for this family that was involved in the accident, and we pray for peace on them and can't imagine the pain that they feel as well. God, we trust that you are good and faithful. Even in the times when it's hard to confess those words again, we trust that and we know that, and so we say it out loud again. God, you're good. We celebrate you today because you alone are worthy of it. We celebrate you because all of the good things we've mentioned today are only because of your work in Ken's life, God. So thank you, God, for your work today. We love you. In your name, amen. Amen. Just a couple closing things that I think you want to know. Like I mentioned, if you responded to the gospel today, we invite you to come on up. We'll have some friends up here to meet with you and just to pray with you and walk you through that. If you came and you noticed there's not a lot of flowers up here, that's because Ken wasn't a really big fan of flowers. How many of you are surprised by that? Not me. And instead, Ken asked that you would give, instead of flowers, that you would give to help send students to camp where they can encounter Christ. And so if you have a gift that you would like to give in Ken's honor, you can drop that in the chest out outside as you're exiting this morning. Write a check payable to First Baptist, Ken Duffy, in the memo line, and that'll go straight to his honor and his memory to send students to camp where they can encounter Christ, much like many of these up here have, many of us all around the room have alongside Ken. I want to ask you to continue praying and supporting Paula and Stephanie and the girls and the family. Keep on reaching out to them in the months and years ahead, even as this starts to fade and life goes on. Keep reaching out to them. Keep walking alongside them. They're going to need it for a long time. And so gratefully, they're surrounded by a great group of friends and loved ones here. Please keep loving on them. Keep praying for them. And so after, as we're done in a moment, I want to invite you to head on out here. We're going to eat in the chapel, and so if you want to stick around for a meal, you're welcome to it. You can head out this way and out to your right when you're walking that direction, and we'll have a meal set up there. One thing we have to do before we leave, you heard it a couple times, so we're going to do it again. You know what's coming. Now, real quick, you need to know, if this is new to you, maybe this is uncomfortable. You're thinking, this I love you God business. Didn't see that one coming. Here's how this works, okay? Ken taught us to pray. But maybe one of the most profound and simple prayers he taught us is just to scream at the top of our lungs. One, two, three.
I love you, God!
Thank you. Have a great day.